Hi, this is a minute of Overpass. My name is Eric and I make apps. Now this week I want to talk about Firebase Analytics. Okay, a few days ago, like on Tuesday, I was invited to a Google event. It was a very small, actually it was an AdMob event. It was a very small event for about 20 developers, kind of like high level developers who get like a lot of downloads and stuff like that. And it was really interesting. I went to one a few years ago and I learned so much that I went again this time. And one of the best things about these kind of events is that you get to meet other developers. And in this kind of field, you know, you don't get to talk to other people so much about, you know, hey, what's working for you, what's not working for you, and all that kind of stuff. So, but this was done by AdMob. So, you know, and one of the things that they focused on a lot was Firebase. Now, I may have mentioned Firebase before. It's one of the things that I'm really, really excited about. Now, one of the things about app development is that if you're an app developer 2 years ago, you know, you might not be using all the latest tools, and you kind of, you know, there's so many things that come out that are real game changers, like cloud platforms, you know, things that like Firebase, which can make your development much easier, much cheaper, the maintenance costs and everything much cheaper. But if you go down that route, you also could, you know, fall into the trap of something like Parse. Like last year, I was like, you know, everything was about Parse. You know, I put it off for like a year, and then finally I thought, you know, Facebook has bought Parse. I'm just going to go ahead and, you know, use Parse in all of our apps. So yeah, and I recommended it for clients. We put it in client apps and everything. And then like this January, you know, they announced that they were closing Parse, and we had to migrate everything off to something else. And some of our apps are still like on Parse. So this is one of the reasons why I go very carefully into something new. But in terms of Firebase, you know, they're using that for everything. They're moving like cloud messaging, analytics, crash reporting, all kinds of stuff into Firebase now. So I was like, it was one of these days where, you know, I went to London in the morning, went to this event, and I when I got home, I just like immediately started, you know, tinkering with this kind of stuff, and I put it into my big apps, put it into EarSpy, EarAssist, and all that kind of stuff. And what I thought I would do this week is kind of show you the kind of results that I get and how it's helping and all this kind of stuff. So now, if you'll have a look at my screen over here, now here's my my Firebase console. Now in here you can set up like projects and everything like that, and you could also import them from Google, which is actually, or from Google Projects, which is pretty good because I was able to take all of my analytics data in. So if I go into EarSpy here, now I've actually included 4 apps in EarSpy. So I have EarSpy. I'm only done Android so far. I've got EarSpy, the pro version of EarSpy, EarAssist, which is just EarSpy in a different color but with a different market, and the EarAssist Pro. But you see here, if I go into this, here you can see the upfront data. I can see, you know, at a glance kind of how many active users we have, how much has been made from in-app purchases so far. Now this is just in the last day or two, so it's not, you know, it's not a big number. And then how many crashes, which considering it's only been a day or two, you know, there's been 14 errors and 7 people have had it crash on them, which is kind of disturbing. But you could go into this and view all the analytics. And I talked before about using analytics, which we were using Google Analytics for everything. One of the things they talked about at this event was that Google Analytics is meant for the web. So things are just a little bit different there, and you get a lot richer features when you go to a Firebase. So let me just show you here. So here's my dashboard. In here I could go through and see things at a glance. I can see we got the active users and then active users compared to last month. So now this is not coming from Firebase alone. This was actually imported from Google Analytics. So I don't start off with just nothing on this one. But you know, it's pretty nice to be able to go through and see that, and then we can see if there's any growth or falling here. We get average revenue. Now my average revenue per user, again, this is just based on the last few days, is a daily at 1 cent. So you know, my when it comes to CPI campaigns or click per install campaigns, I'm driving mostly off of AdMob and mostly off of ad revenue. So in terms of in-app purchases, we get quite a bit. It's not bad, but it's not great either. So, but my average revenue per paying user, $2.97. I also get the first open attribution. Now, the first open is not really the download, but it's the first time they actually open the app. So here I can see how many people are coming from just direct. So they're doing a Google Play search. And I can also see here from Google, which is 191. Now I am, for the last few weeks, I have been running a CPI campaign for EarSpy. It's a very low install. I think my bid was at like 5p per install. Now I moved it up to 7p per install, which is actually losing money, but it's still hoping to get it up the ranks a little bit there. So, there's ulterior motives there. I got the retention over here. I've got user engagement. Now, to be frankly honest with you, a lot of this stuff I'm not going to be able to really use until I start getting some more data there. But how many the in-app purchases? Which ones are they actually buying? I've got a few here that say not set. I'm not entirely sure why. I can see who's actually installed the latest version. So the latest version, which I just released the other day with this one, was 1.4.12, and we see that they're starting to actually get it here, and this is actually based on the date, so it's not too much here. Devices, it's the thing with Android. There's so many different types of devices out there. This information is pretty much useless in terms of the model. You got like a little bit here. We got 4, and then other is like 96%. But I've got the OS version, where that's pretty useful. I mean, it's Android's 6, the latest version of Android is up there pretty high. In terms of location, this is always good. 31% coming from the US. Brazil's at 7.3%, and they're pretty much evenly split through the rest there. But this is something that I didn't get before, or at least I had no idea how to find it in Google Analytics before, because I wasn't capturing this data. I don't do Facebook logins or anything like that, so I don't capture demographic data on the users. However, with Firebase, we seem to be getting that in there, so I can see that the majority of my users are male, 77.7%. They're mostly 25 to 34. And then also have this over here, the interest. So this is interesting. So I can see what people are interested in. So if I'm gonna launch a campaign, like I could go into my CPI campaign either here, or if I do another one on Facebook for some other app or for this app, I could target those a little bit better. So rather than wasting money on I target everybody. I could just target on people who like arts and entertainment, but that's a pretty broad category. All right, so, and up here along the top here, you've got different things. So I'm tracking several events. So when I went and put this into the code, I did manually put some events in there. However, some of them are just out of the box. Like some of these you can see with lower numbers are the ones I've added, but some of them are just in there. So you can see how many people have removed the app, how many first opens, how many people have updated the app. So you can see I have a lot of removes. When I talk about we have a high number of downloads, we also have a high number of uninstalls because people try it out and then they run out of space and they move stuff off their phone. But you can see here we also have the in-app purchases. So it's whereas you could go into Google Wallet and see the big everything together, or you could go into Google Play and go into the revenue section and see like a split out a little bit. I prefer seeing it here. I want to see everything kind of in one place. So that's kind of good. And again, this is just last 30 days, which doesn't include today. If I check today, we got a few more here, 8 more, but. It's kind of good to be able to go through and see those events. And if I drill down here, I could go to first open and see, again, split by, where they're actually coming from and the source over there. So I also got audiences. So again, see, the demographics of the users. So I can see, how many people are actually purchasers, 12 as compared to 145,000 users. So, you know, when we talk, you know, generally when I talk to other app developers, they talk about having a 2% conversion rate, and I have nothing near that. I have like a point, maybe a 0.002 conversion rate, but that's just for my app. A lot of my users, I don't think they actually have, you know, they don't have Google Wallet accounts set up and that kind of stuff. So a lot of the stuff comes from advertising. Funnels, this is something I haven't used yet, you know, to be honest with you. Again, just playing around with it the last few days. Cohorts, you can see how long people are using it. But again, since it's just been a few days, it's not really useful data to me yet. And then user properties, and this is like if you add, like, say if you had like a Facebook login, and it's, you know, I've heard about this before, it's always good to have people log in through Facebook because you get a lot more information about the user than you would if you just say, give me your email and password. You can sit and you get the gender. Depending on, you know, what permissions you ask for, you can get like the you can get the email address as a separate permission, but you can get like the date of birth and stuff like that. So that kind of stuff, you know, if you had that and you wanted to pass it into here, you could also view it here. So that's, you know, this is mainly what I've been looking at is the analytics. But if you look along the side here, I mean, Firebase is just so cool. My only trepidation is because being burned by Parse last year or this year. So, but you know, now we're starting to really start to move everything in there, and we even start trying to migrate some of our apps from Parse into Firebase. But you know, it's one of the nice things. I mean, there's other nice features here that we're starting to use on some of our apps. There's auth, which is authorization. So like, you know, when you could say you can log in from Twitter or Facebook or Google or whatever, this all has it all in one place, so you can use their auth libraries or their authentication libraries and have everything handled for you through here. You got database, which is like a real-time database, which I don't have anything in there now, but you can you can have like a bit like Parse, where you have like a NoSQL database in the cloud. The nice thing about the SDKs though is it updates dynamically. So, you know, if you're online, it uses the online one. If you're offline, it uses the cached version. Storage, again, that's for files. Hosting, if you're gonna host a website on here or something that uses the rest of Firebase and you just need like an actual place for people to go. Test lab is a bit like, like the Amazon testing one, so you can upload something and have it tested in multiple devices. Haven't used it yet, that's one of the paid features. And crash reporting, again, adding this in was kind of nice. You get crash reporting in Google Play, but I've never been able to make much use out of it, except, you know, because it's so hard to find. You have to drill down in there. And what I really want to do is see all the apps together and see some crash reporting there. So, you know, here you get to see it a little bit more. Again, it's still separated by app, so. And then you got the push notification. So, you know, whereas before, you know, it was always kind of awkward. Now you got push notifications, which you can send from here. Remote config, if you had something, other app developers I know have used Google Tag Manager for stuff like this before. So let's say you want to, and somebody mentioned it in the comments a few weeks ago when we were talking about this. So if you wanted to say something like hide the banner or have conditional things within the app which you can control remotely, rather than re-release a new version, you can set it as a parameter in here and then change it within the app, within here. So let's say you have a special banner for Christmas or something that you want to show up, you could go in here and set that. Or let's say you're trying out a new feature, but you're not sure if it's going to work. You could say show the unlock button, and then you could try the unlock button. If nobody's clicking on it, you could go ahead and, you know, set that to false and have it hidden for everybody. Dynamic links is, I don't know what it is. It's some sort of deep linking thing. And then AdMob. So one of the things that the analytics has that I have not been able to make use of, I haven't been able to get heads or tail of, is using analytics link with AdMob. Now, this is one of the things, I mean, I found so much documentation on how do you link your Firebase analytics with AdMob, but I don't see any data coming through. I mean, we have, you know, hundreds of thousands of impressions being served, but I don't see anything that helps me here. What I really want to be able to see is, I want to be able to do a CPI campaign or a click cost per install campaign based on, say, like people who normally click ads. You know, that's kind of stuff that, you know, that I would think of, because they might be more, you know, like it might be worth me if somebody's like a normal ad clicker. I don't know, maybe they have fat thumbs, or maybe they're, you know, easily distracted. Maybe that'd be worth me paying, you know, $7 a user, or per install and stuff like that. So anyway, it's still early days. I think it's really cool technology. Again, because of Parse, I'm not quite sure, but you go talk to an app developer who has been around in, like, say, 2010, 2012, you know, they're still building their own back-end systems. I know a lot of app developers who are still writing their own back-ends in, like, PHP. They're not even using Node. They're using PHP, MySQL, the stuff that they know, but it's really slow, especially if you have a large user base. You know, one of the things is I can have an app that works really well here because my server's in the UK, but, you know, users in the States might say it's a bit sluggish, as users in China especially. So, you know, one of the nice things about having a cloud solution like Firebase or, you know, even Heroku or one of the other ones is that you can scale that out, you know, really easily. So again, the cost of everything keeps going down. You know, technology moves so fast. It's, you know, you never know if you're paying too much or too little. You know, everybody comes to you with their new platform, so you don't know which one to go with. You don't want to be burned. You don't want to go to something that is going to be replaced, you know, really quick by somebody else. And but, you know, I think Firebase is cool. If you've used it, let me know what your experiences are. If you've been able to get it to work with AdMob, especially, let me know what your experiences are in the comments. And I hope this has been useful. Now, I keep forgetting to do the outro every week, so I'm just gonna say it. If you like the video, please click like, and if you haven't subscribed yet, please subscribe. You'll be able to, you know, hear everything. Every Friday we do these videos. And also leave a comment. You know, I love to hear what people have to say. You know, it's nice that we have a nice little community going here, and you know, yeah, I read all the comments and hear what everybody says. I answer all the questions, or I try to answer all the questions. And I really appreciate it. And also, if you're interested in following more closely, here's a Snapchat short code. And I do snaps every day, and a lot of people seem to like them. And that's it. I'll talk to you next week.